Well, good morning. How's everyone doing today? What an awesome day of worship so far, of coming together and worshiping God this morning. It's just been incredible. I hope everyone's had a great summer so far. We're in the so-called dog days of summer, right? We just passed July 4th, and summer just continues to drag on and drag on. But today, like we have every Sunday, we get the opportunity to open the Word of God. So if you have your Bible with you, I invite you to open it up to Joshua chapter 11. That's where we're at this morning. And before we go in there, I just ask that you pray with me. Dear God, thank you so much for this day that you've given us thus far. Thank you that we've had the opportunity, the privilege to come before the throne of thrones and to worship you, to declare the greatness of who you are, God. Thank you that you are constant, that you never change, despite our weaknesses and so many times that we change. Lord, you never change, and your faithfulness is everlasting and everlasting. God, I pray that as we open up your word, Lord, that you would speak to us. God, that you would challenge us and confront us and change us, God. Convict us by your word, O Lord. Lord, I pray that you would forgive me right off the bat in my foolish ramblings. God, no one's come to hear me. We've come to hear you this morning through your word. So God, we thank you. Thank you that your word is alive and that it's doing your work even right now. Lord, in your name we pray. Amen. So like I said again, I hope everyone's been enjoying their summer. One of the things that I really don't like about summertime is the junk that is on TV, right? Well, all year long, junk is on TV, but particularly in the summertime, there's like really nothing on. I mean, unless you're a fan of sharks, it's been a good week for you this past week, or, you know, I'm just counting down the days for football season to start. Anybody ready for football season? Man, amen, right, yes. But, you know, there is one show that my family and I have kind of adopted and kind of become a really big fan of, and I think we're kind of slow on the go on this, because it's been around for a few years, and that is The American Ninja Warrior. Anyone ever seen that show? This is amazing, all right? So we were sitting on the couch, my family and I, just, you know, oh, Dad, there's nothing on TV, so I'm flipping through the channel, and all of a sudden, we see these guys and girls compete and do these amazing things and do these crazy, ridiculous obstacles, and it was awesome. It was so cool, and these stories of the perseverance that these folks have to go through in life and train up. And then sometimes some of the characters, the folks there that compete, dress up in these awesome costumes, right? They got these crazy hair and they got the capes on. I mean, it's amazing. It's incredible. Great entertainment. The thing I love about The American Ninja Warrior is that with each challenge, each episode, the challenge or obstacle gets harder and harder. And they've got to overcome those obstacles and overcome those challenges. Our very own Pastor James, he's not stud or trained to be an American Ninja Warrior, but this very morning, the dude ran a triathlon. I mean, that. So, you know, that's inspiring to me, you know. I mean, so Pastor James is training, and he did pretty well. I think he's still walking around back there. Anyone want to give him some back rubs? I'm sure he'll take that. But so as people, we love challenges, or for the most part, we love conquering obstacles. We love overcoming those things. And at the end, when we've conquered them, I mean, we see it when we watch the show. These folks are pumped up. They're pointing to the crowd. They're pointing to the more. Yeah, that's right. I did that. That's right. Right? And so we love a good challenge. At the same time, though, life brings us challenges that we don't like. Life brings us obstacles that we're not ready for, that we're not prepared for. And God, through the life of the believer, is constantly challenging us, constantly testing our faith in Him, not to so that we would doubt, but that our faith would be strengthened and that our faith would be strong in Him. James chapter 1 says it this way. James chapter 1 says, "Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. God wants our faith to be an everlasting, strong faith in Him, to not doubt in Him, but to believe and to trust in Him, that He's got it all under control. And sometimes, well, a lot of times, that is so hard for us to take because we don't like those challenges. We don't like those obstacles. And that is exactly what the nation of Israel and Joshua has been going through. From chapter 1 through chapter 11, all this great book that we've been reading, God has been putting these people through the fire, through obstacles. They've had to face difficult challenges time and time again. For one thing and one thing only, God has been bringing these people through these obstacles so that they would trust in Him, that they would not trust in their own strength and trust in themselves, but that Joshua and the nation of Israel would trust in God and God alone. We've seen that through the battle of Jericho, remember? And then through the next phase, the city of Ai, and all the southern conquests that they've conquered this great land of Canaan. Time and time again, they've been outnumbered, outmatched, scared. And time again, there's a constant. God has been encouraging them. Do not fear. Be strong. Be courageous, for I am with you. And so we find ourselves in Joshua chapter 11 this morning. Joshua chapter 11. And verse 1, here's where we are in this whole thing. The nation of Israel and Joshua, they've conquered southern Canaan, and they're here in the central part of Canaan, and their fame has spread. And the people of Canaan are like, what is going on? And the northern realms now are like, we have got to deal with the Joshua and these Israelites once and for all. So we get introduced to this king Hazor, in chapter 11, verse 1. And so he's going to gather all of the kingdoms, all of the cities, all the countries in the northern land of Canaan, and they're going to come together and form this huge coalition and face the nation of Israel and wipe them out. That's their thought. Read along with me in verse 1. Then it came about when Jabin, king of Hazor, heard of it, that he sent to Jobab, king of Madon, and to the king of Shimron, and to the king of Aksif, and to the kings who were in the north in the hill country, and in the Arba, and south of Chinora. And I know I'm botching up all these names, but you get the point. All these kings have gathered together. Verse 3, to the Canaanite in the east, on the west, and the Amorite, and the Hittite, and the Perizzite, and the Jebusite, and in the hill country, in the Hivite, at the foot of Hermon, and the land of Mizpah. Verse 4, they came out, they and all their armies with them. Listen to this. As many people as the sand that is on the seashore, with very many horses and chariots. The historian Josephus says it like this. There was about 300,000 armed soldiers. And then, so not only do we have now armed soldiers to contend with, now we've got horses and chariots to contend with. We've got about 10,000 cavalry, 10,000 horses. We've got about 20,000 chariots. You get the picture, right? A mass army is now ready to face Israel. And you can tell what their response is, what their response has been time and time again. They're afraid. They're afraid. They're fearful. Look at verse 6. Then the Lord said to Joshua, do not be afraid because of them. For tomorrow at this time, I will deliver all of them slain before Israel. You shall hamstring their horses and burn their chariots with fire. You see, God once again is teaching the Israelites a valuable lesson. And He's teaching us this same lesson, that we can trust in God. No matter what happens, no matter what we're faced with, no matter what the nation of Israel was faced with, no matter what Joshua was faced with, they could trust in God. And He reminds them time and time again. In fact, that's what this whole book has been about, is about the nation of Israel trusting in God, that God has them in His hands. And He's giving us the same challenge, that we can trust God. In this chapter, we're going to find three reasons why we can trust God. Actually, two reasons. And the third point is the result of that trust, what God does for us. And so, number one, we can trust God because nothing is too great for Him. nothing is too great for God. That's why we can trust him. And we have this one more example of this. This great mass of army, as many as the sand on the seashore, the nation of Israel is about to face. But God says to Joshua in verse 6, "Do not be afraid because of them. You shall hamstring their horses and burn their chariots." And so verse 7, we continue to read. "So Joshua and all the people of war with him came upon them suddenly by the waters and attacked them." This is kind of cool right here. I don't want to miss this point, because where the nation of Israel was at, stationed at this point, was in this area called Gilgal in central Canaan. And so to the north of them is where this mass, huge army had gathered. It was about a 2 days walk, or a day and a half, or 2 days walk. Well, we read, because of this confidence now that Israel had and Joshua and the army had, that the Lord again encourages them to not be afraid. They are fired up. They're fired up. And so they rush out, and they, like in a day's time, overnight, they surprise this mass army to the north. Verse 8, "The Lord delivered them into the hand of Israel so that they defeated them and pursued them as far as the great Sidon and that other place in the valley of Mizpah to the east. And they struck," listen to this, "and they struck them until no survivor was left to them." This great mass army, they were outnumbered. Number one, they were outnumbered in strength and number. Number two, they were outnumbered by technology, right? Now they've got horses and chariots to deal, but they were no match for God, because nothing is too great for God. Verse 9, "Joshua did to them as the Lord had told him. He hamstrung their horses and burned their chariots with fire." This is so cool. I don't want to miss this either. Because why would they take out the horses? Why would God want them to burn the chariots? Turn over to the book of Psalms. Psalm chapter 20. David, the psalmist David, King David at the time, was also at war. He was also at war, battling. And he dealt with this issue of trusting in God. Trusting in God. And look what he says here. He sings the psalm to the Lord. Verse 7, chapter 20, he says this, "Some boast in chariots and some in horses, but we will boast in the name of the Lord our God." We won't trust in anything else, but we will boast, put our trust in the name of the Lord our God. God did not want the nation of Israel and Joshua to trust in the things, the horses and the chariots. He wanted them to trust in him and him alone. And so he said, wipe out everything. Get rid of those horses. Get rid of the chariots and just trust in me. Verse 10, back to Joshua chapter 11. "Then Joshua turned back at the time. He captured Hazor, the king who organized this whole thing. Struck him down with the sword, for Hazor formerly was the head of all these kingdoms. And they struck every person who was in it with the edge of the sword, utterly destroying them. There was no one left who breathed. And he burned Hazor with fire." God doesn't mess around. Joshua captured all the cities of these kings and all their kings, and he struck them with the edge of the sword and utterly destroyed them, just as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded. Again, nothing is too great for God. Jump down to verse 21. Verse 21 of chapter 11. Just another example, God showing these people of just how great he is and that nothing is too great for God. Verse 21, the last group of people that Joshua and the Israelite nation cut off here. "Then Joshua came at that time and cut off the Anakim from the hill country, from Hebron, and cast them out. And Joshua utterly destroyed them with their cities." So what is so important? What is so cool about these people, the Anakim? Turn back to Numbers. If you're in your Bible, Numbers chapter 13. Numbers chapter 13, verse 33. You see, a little historical context here. Some 40 years before this, God had commanded Moses to go out into the land and to take the land for the people. And so he sent out 12 spies to go out and scout out this land to see if what it was like, what the people were like. You guys remember that when we first started this series? So the 12 spies went out. 10 of them came back with one report, and 2 of them came back with another report. Remember the 2? Joshua and Caleb, right? They had their own report. They said, we got this. We can totally take these people, right? They're nothing compared to our God. But the other 10, they had a different account. They had a different report to give. And it was all because of this group. They said, yeah, the land is good. The land flows with milk and honey. It's all good. It's sweet. But there's this one group of people, they will crush us like grasshoppers. Look at Numbers chapter 13, verse 33. This is the report of the 10 spies. There also we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, who were part of the Nephilim, and we became like grasshoppers in our own sight. And so we were there, in their sight. So they see this group of people, the Anakim, these giants, and they're fearful and terrified. And they say, there's no way we can take these people. We're so afraid. There's no way we can take the land, Moses. And so, because of their lack of faith, God makes them wait another 40 years. Well, here we are. Jump forward. Finally, Joshua and the nation of Israel, they've wiped out all of Canaan. They've conquered the land. And finally, just God to say to them, remember those people who you were very terrified of? Even they're no match for me. Joshua cast them out at the total end, just as an exclamation mark. We can trust God because nothing is too great for Him. And so how does that apply to us? Undoubtedly, we have obstacles we face, right? Life gets hard. Life is unbearable at times. And I don't know about you, I so need to hear this, that nothing is too great for God, because I get so bogged down, I get so weighed down amidst the pressures of life, being a dad, being a husband, being an employer, just doing life. Life gets heavy, doesn't it? And to top that off, things happen. Sickness, the death of a loved one, things happen that are totally out of our control. And we are so overburdened and overbearing. God wants us to hear this morning, that we can trust Him even in the midst of all of that. That nothing is too great for Him. Turn to the book of Isaiah with me. Isaiah chapter 40. I believe we as a church need to hear this morning. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28 says this. The prophet Isaiah, this is the Lord speaking through the prophet Isaiah. Verse 28 says this, do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired. His understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases power. Are you feeling weary this morning? Burdened? Tired, overwhelmed, know this, that the God of the universe who sits on high on His throne will give you strength so that you will not become weary. If you lack might, He will give you the power to overcome that obstacle. The God, the everlasting God who sits on the throne, He wants to give you His strength. And we as a church need to hear this, don't we? We as a church need to trust God because nothing is too great for Him. Well, secondly, back to Joshua chapter 11. We can trust God because His word never changes. Look down with me at Joshua chapter 11, starting in verse 16, says this. Thus Joshua took all that the land, the hill country, and all the Negev, and all the Goshen, the lowland, the Arabah, the hill country of Israel, and its lowland. This is essentially just a summary of what Joshua and God has done in conquering the land of Canaan. Verse 18, Joshua waged war a long time with these kings. It's estimated that this whole battle, this whole war took place for about 6 years. 6 years' time. Verse 19, there was not a city which made peace with the sons of Israel, except for the Hivites living in Gibeon. Verse 20, for it was the Lord to harden their hearts. Listen to that. For it was of the Lord to harden their hearts to meet Israel in battle, in order that he might utterly destroy them, that they might receive no mercy, but that he might destroy them, just as the Lord commanded Moses. And you're saying, okay, why is this important? This is important because back many, many years ago, the Lord commanded Moses and gave forth his word that this people would destroy, God, through the nation of Israel, would destroy this land of Canaan. Because it was God's judgment upon this people. This people were a wicked people. They turned away from God, and God was judging them. And that was his word. And God did not back down from his word. God commanded Moses 40-something years ago, and now that fulfillment has finally come true through Joshua. God does not back down on his word, and his word never changes. That's not like us, is it? Our words change constantly. I was reminded of this, not because of me. I have to thank my son, Joshua Guest, for this next illustration. So if you see him, you can thank him for it. All right. He's a huge NBA fan, loves the NBA. And because of that, I have to suffer through it. Well, not really. I like the NBA too, right? So the NBA just had this cool period of free agency where teams can jump to another team and vice versa. A lot of stuff going on. Well, there's this one instance where this one player, a star player on the Los Angeles Clippers, Pastor Matt's favorite team, right? And so he decided, you know what? I'm going to test the free agent market. I'm going to go to another team. He felt a little, uncared for in L.A. for some reason. So he goes to Dallas Mavericks, and Mark Cuban gives him this great, great pitch, and he says, all right, I'm there. And he gives him his word that he'll be a part of their team. What happens? A couple of days later, he changes his mind. Goes back on his word and signs with the Clippers. Pastor Matt's happy. All right, he's ecstatic. Pastor James, who's a Dallas Maverick fan, not happy. All right? So I don't care because I don't like either of the teams. Okay? But the point is, this guy totally backed out on his word. And I do this all the time. I make promises to my kids. Oh, I'll be there. Something comes up, and I've got to say, oh, I can't be there. I make an appointment to have lunch with somebody. Oh, something comes up, I can't make it. We do this all the time, right? We back out on stuff, and things happen. Our word, it just isn't as good as it used to be because things happen, circumstances happen, things change. God's word never changes. His word is established forever and forever. Nothing impacts his word. Look at, if you're still in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. I'll just read it. You guys, listen to this verse. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. The word of our God stands forever, and that's why we can trust him, because his word never changes. Why is this so important for us to understand? Why is it so important for us to grasp this? Because, my friends, we live in a day and age where the word means little. Things are compromised. We must accept everything. We see that in our culture, right? Even it has infiltrated in our church. I was having coffee with a good friend this past week, and we were talking about, okay, what is the biggest challenge of our church today? And what he said, and I totally agree with, our church doesn't stand on anything. It's become so wishy-washy. False doctrine has filtered in, and no one has a strong faith to stand on. As a church, this is a constant battle that we deal with. It started way back at the beginning of humanity, right? When the enemy came and deceived Adam and Eve and to see the truth that God had established. And it's been an ongoing occurrence. As a church, we need to be aware of that, that God's word never changes, and we need to be firmly rooted in that. Here's why. If you have your Bibles, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. God established the church. He gave, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, He gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers. For what purpose? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. Why? Verse 14 says this, as a result, we are no longer to be children, tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming. My friends, God wants us firmly established in His truth so that we are not tossed here and there by winds of false doctrine. And you need to know this. The enemy wants us deceived. He wants us to be tossed here and there by false doctrine, doesn't he? God wants us to be standing firm on His truth. That's why we as a church hold fast, hold so strongly to the Word of God. So we can trust God because His Word never changes. Finally, back to Joshua chapter 11. And again, Joshua, the Lord has been reminding Joshua and these people throughout all these epic battles, all these epic challenges of why they should trust in Him. That He is bigger than anything they can ever imagine. Nothing is too great for God to handle. His word is true. And He's constantly telling, trust me, trust in me. Do not fear, do not be afraid. Trust me, I've got this. And here's what happens when we finally trust God. Joshua chapter 11, verse 23. So Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to Israel according to their divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. When we trust in God, even in the midst of everything going on, even in the midst of huge obstacles, huge challenges, in the midst of the mundaneness of life, when we submit to God and trust in God, we receive rest. Rest. I love that word, rest. This past week, I was up at night. I couldn't rest. Lots of stuff going in my head, worries, nervousness, trying to prepare. And so I was walking around the house, 2 a.m., and I go to my kids' rooms. What are they doing? They're resting. Resting. Peaceful rest. Trusting in mommy and daddy, right? Trusting that they're protected, that they're being cared for. I wish I could rest like that. God wants us to trust Him. And the thing about trust, it's tricky. Because with trust, if we need to trust God, it means we can't trust in ourselves. We've got to let that go. And that's hard, isn't it? It's hard because we like to think we've got it under control. We like to think, God, you've got the big stuff, but this little stuff, like my job, how I handle my kids, finances, I can handle that. No, God wants all of that. He wants us to trust Him with everything. And that requires submission. Ooh, that's a word we don't like to use, right? Submission. That's what God's been teaching the nation of Israel this whole time. Submit to me. Submit to me. Trust me. Acknowledge who I am. Honor me. Don't trust in horses and chariots. Don't trust in anything else but me and me alone. Because you know what? I've got this. I've got you in my hand. Nothing will separate you from me. My word is secure. Nothing will shake it. And He's telling us the same thing. But for some of us, that's hard. For me, that's hard. But when we do that, we find rest. Turn to Matthew chapter 11. This is where we'll close. The Lord knew this. He sent His Son, Jesus, to come to live the perfect life that we could not live. And Christ in His ministry knew exactly what our struggle would be, to not trust in ourselves, but to trust in God and God alone. And He challenged the people, His disciples, to have faith, to trust in Him, to constantly trust in Him. And in Matthew chapter 11, a familiar verse to a lot of us, but it really hit me this week. And here's Christ crying out to us. Hear the words of our Lord this morning. Matthew 11, verse 28. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. My friends, are you heavy laden this morning? Are you burdened with life this morning? If we're honest with ourselves, you better believe it. Life is tough. It's hard. No matter if you're a teenager, elementary child, whatever phase in your life gets hard and it's burdensome. And what makes it even more difficult is when we think we can do it in our own strength. When we think we've got it, when we fool ourselves to think we can control it all. We don't need any help. Christ is crying out to you. Stop that nonsense. Come to me. Trust in me. Lay your burdens upon me, and I will give you rest. You know, we sang a song this morning. Always. One of my favorite songs. And one of the verses, it goes like this. Troubles surround me. Chaos abounding. My soul will rest in you. I will not fear. I will not fear. His promise is true. My God will come through. My God will not delay. My refuge and strength always, always. God wants to give you His rest. He's crying out to you. He's pleading with you. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden. I will give you rest. My soul will rest in God. This morning, maybe you're here. And this is all kind of new to you. This whole God thing and learning about God and your whole life. You've thought you've had it figured out. You thought, you know what, I'm my own man, I'm my own woman. I've got this life thing figured out. Yeah, sometimes things get sloppy or messy, but I don't need any help. That was the same lie that Satan gave Adam and Eve. You don't need God. And we call that sin. We want to do things in our own strength, when we deny who God is, when we turn away from God and His compassion and mercy and authority, that's sin. And God, He can't stand sin. And He separated on that moment when sin entered the world, He separated Himself from humanity because their eyes were open and they did not want any part of God. And sin does that to us. In our hearts, it corrupts us, and we realize we don't want anything to do with God and what He has because we think we can do it in our own strength. And so we're separated. But God, in His perfectness, in His love and mercy, sent His Son to live the perfect life, to die the death that we deserve because of that sin, because of that separation. So that if you would come to Him and lay down your life upon Christ and believe upon the name of the Lord, your sins will be forgiven. And upon that day, upon that belief, upon that faith, God the Father is no longer separated from you. He no longer sees your sin, the separation of that sin that has caused, but he sees you clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. He no longer sees the filth of that sinful heart. He sees you white as snow. So if you're here this morning, you've never put your trust in Christ, you don't have to walk the aisle. You don't have to do anything but believe in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's close our eyes. Let's bow our heads. If that's you this morning, you can have a prayer with God right now. He's pleading with you. He's calling after you. He's crying after you. Come to me. And you can pray to him something like this. God, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've tried to do this thing I've called life in my own strength, in my own ability. But God, I'm tired. I'm tired and I'm weary. And I ask you that you would forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of trying to do this life in my own strength. I ask that you would come into my heart, change me, renew me, give me your strength, your life. And then thank him. And God is so faithful, so good. He claims in his word, it says, if they confess your sins before me, I am faithful and just to forgive you. And he forgives you. And upon that belief, upon him forgiving you, you are locked, secure in his hands forever and ever. If that's you this morning, if you've prayed that prayer just now, had that conversation, I want to know. We're not here to embarrass you. I want to celebrate. I want to cry out and sing praises to God because of that, because of the work he's done in your life. So if that's you, would you slip up your hand? If you've accepted Christ, amen, I see you. I see your hand, thank you. I see your hand, sir, thank you. Praise God Almighty, because you were once lost and now you are found. You once were blind and now your eyes have been opened and now you're firmly secure in God's sovereign hand. For the rest of us, no matter what troubles surround us, no matter what chaos abounds amongst us, our soul can find rest in God and God alone. He's crying out to us, come to him, come to him, take his yoke, his burden is light, and he will give us rest. Do you trust God this morning? Maybe there's something holding you back. Maybe there's that one thing that you don't want to give away to God. Well, you know what? Now's the time to give it to him because he wants to give you that rest. Let's pray. Father God, you are so good. Lord, we need your help in this. We cannot trust in you in our own strength. God, would you give us your strength, your power, so that we can submit to you and trust in you, the only God, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. And God, thank you for the rest that you give us, oh God. And I pray that today, we would start renewing our trust in you with everything that we have. Everything, God, we give it to you and we trust in you.